We've seen a lot of different ways that we can manipulate data. Now, one of the biggest tasks that we're going to have is to get some insights from that data, that we're going to want to be able to try and predict certain behaviors, try and predict certain values. Now, in order to do that, what we'll need is to split up our data that we'll need to be able to say, hey, these are all of the things that are going to impact some particular value. Or to put this another way, to give you a couple of different examples or scenarios that given X data predict Y value. So for example, given a particular customer, I want to be able to predict whether or not they're going to buy a product. Or given a shopping cart, I want to be able to offer up some other items that that customer might be interested in. If you've ever shopped online, you've seen this behavior where you've seen that little spot that says other customers have bought. This is exactly what's happening behind the scenes, is it's a little bit of machine learning. And along those lines, with our data, since we've been looking at flight data, that what we want to be able to do is say, given a particular flight, predict the time that it's going to be delayed, whether or not it's going to be early, etc. But in order to do that, what we're going to need to do is to take our data and split it up. That we're going to need to create two different data frames. That we're going to want to set up the label data frame, basically what we want to predict. In our case, that's going to be how late or how early is a particular flight going to be, into a data frame commonly labeled as Y, and in particular, a lowercase y. I know I've said previously my challenges with single letter variable names and things like that. This is convention, so I do follow along with it, even though it pains me inside. So the value that we're going to predict is going to be in Y. So in our case, the value that we want to predict is the minutes early or minutes late that it's going to wind up being, that particular flight would wind up being. The data that's going to influence this, and this is going to include things like the time of departure, the time of arrival, the airport that it took off from, the airport that it was going to, etc. All of that information is going to make up the features or what's going to influence the label. So if you stop and think about it, the airport that we're coming from, the airport that we're going to, when you're talking about things like weather, air traffic control, etc., all of those different things are going to have an impact on whether or not a flight is early or a flight is late. So we're going to take all of that information, put that off somewhere else into a different data frame. This data frame is going to be labeled as capital X. So if we want to take a look at a little bit more of a concrete example here, what we're going to notice is we've got the distances, we've got the elapsed time, and then we've got the arrival delay. So 7 minutes, 4 minutes early, 5 minutes, etc., the whole way down. What we want to be able to predict, or our label, is going to be that delay, and everything else is going to influence it. So if we remember from what we had before, using that location indexer, we're able to go get all of the rows for that arrival delay column, and then in turn, we can go grab all of the features by just grabbing everything else. And we can either list them off like we have here, or maybe if it was basically everything but that last column, we could have gone ahead and set up a range where we indicated, hey, go 0 to whatever it might be. The end result is going to wind up being that we'll have two different data frames, X and Y, where X is going to be all of our features, and Y is going to be the label that we're going to be trying to predict. You're also going to notice that the index is going to come along for the ride. That gives us the ability and also gives our trainer the ability to align everything properly so that way we know which pieces of data are going to be correlated to which eventual results here. Now, the other thing that we're typically going to have to do is to split up our data into training data and testing data. When we think about trying to train up a machine learning model, or really kind of train anything up, what we're going to need to do is feed it some information. Hey, this is what's going on. We're going to make some assumptions based on that information, and then we're going to want to be able to test our assumptions. Like, this is kind of how we learn, that we'll learn something, and then we'll go off and we'll test that behavior, and we'll see, hey, is this in fact the case? Is this not the case? That's exactly what we're going to do when we're setting up our machine learning model. That we're going to say, hey, this is the information that I want you to use to train yourself, and then this is the information that I want you to use to confirm that all of those assumptions that you've now generated are in fact correct. Typically, you're only going to have one set of data. So what you'll do is take that one set of data, take some of the rows, turn that into the training data, and then some of the rows, and turn that into the testing data. So you're going to notice that we've got our data frame X. What we're going to do is we're going to split that up into some training data and into some testing data. I want you to notice the indexes here. And you're going to notice that on the training side, we're going to have 0 and 2, whereas on the test side, we're going to have 1 and 17. Everything else that's there is sort of irrelevant. The takeaway that I want you to get out of this is we didn't just simply say, all right, well, the top 70%, that's what we're going to use to train, and then the bottom 30% is what we're going to use to validate all of those assumptions that we're going to use to test. Because that's not really going to give us good results, because information could be skewed. It's possible, depending on our data set, where it is that we've loaded it in from, that maybe there was a sort that took place. So maybe, for example, everything is sorted based on the destination airport. So now what I'm going to wind up with down at the very bottom is everything that's landing in, I'm trying to think of an airport code that starts with like a Z. So whatever that might be, I'm just going to use SEA, SeaTac, just because S is sort of a later letter. So let's say that I've got Seattle down at the very bottom. So now that winds up becoming my testing data. So all of the assumptions are going to be based on everything but Seattle. And then I'm going to wind up testing those assumptions against Seattle. And you could easily see, hey, that's not really a good way to do things. So instead, what we want to do is we want to randomize this, so that way we're not going to be biasing our training and our testing. So when we go in and we look at our results, we look at our accuracy, we're going to know, oh, okay, we've done a good job here. We're testing this and training this on some nice random values. That's exactly what's happening here. So as a general rule, train on 70% of your data and test on 30% of your data, somewhere in that ballpark. It's a general nice starting point. It's a nice general rule of thumb that you can follow. Now, there's a nice little library that's available to us called scikit-learn that does an awful lot of really nice things in this space. One of the things that it does is offers us a train-test split. And what's great about this is we can actually just give it our X data frame and our Y data frame, so our features and our label, and then it will give us back everything that we might want. So we pull that little function in, then we go ahead and call it, and what you're going to notice is that it will give us back that X train, X test, Y train, Y test, where X train is going to be all the features we're going to train on, X test is what we're going to use to test all of those assumptions that are generated. And then the Y train and Y test is going to do the exact same thing, except for the values that we want to be able to predict. Again, that's going to be that label. X and Y is what we're coming in with. The test size is where we're going to indicate how we're going to split everything up. Now, the last item that's on there is the random state. Now, we're setting the random state to a value here, And by doing that, we're now seeding how random values are going to be generated. So at the end of the day, when you specify a random state, you're actually not going to be getting random values anymore because it's always going to be basing it on that exact same seed. The reason that you might decide to do this is if you're looking for some level of replayability, so that maybe what I want to be able to do is to test out different algorithms or otherwise, and I want to make sure that we're always doing it on the exact same training data and on the exact same testing data. So that's why you might decide to set that random state. The end result of all of this is we're going to start with a data frame that looks a little bit like this, where what we want to be able to do is to predict our delay. So we're going to split off our distance and our elapsed time into the x side. We're going to set up the y side as the predicted delay. And then you'll also notice that we're going to have our train section and we're going to have our test section. And we'll be able to use those to in turn train up our model. Let's go in and see a couple of code examples so we can hopefully bring all of this together.